Do you trust me? I hope so. All of us want to be trusted. Trust is a basic element of everyday life. To trust others is a normal reaction. Many of us have traveled on a train or a bus. Did we worry whether the conductor or driver would bring us safely to our destination? Normally, we do not worry. We trust an airplane captain to take us safely to our destination. We trust that when we enter an elevator, that it will not crash at the bottom of the shaft, but safely take us to the desired floor. When we marry, we trust that our partner will remain faithful. In many situations in life, we need trust. What is trust? Trust is the firm belief in the reliability, truth, or ability of someone or something. Webster's dictionary says that it is confidence, a reliance or resting of the mind on the integrity, veracity, justice, friendship, or other sound principle of another person. Trust is related to confidence, belief, faith, and assurance. Experiments conducted by Professor Dr. Michael Kosfeld, a professor at a university in Frankfurt, Germany, led him to the conclusion that trust is a biologically based part of human nature. Kosfeld discovered that when there's interaction between two people, the human brain releases a hormone that stimulates trust. It is, in fact, one of the distinguishing features of the human species, Kosfeld states. In everyday life, how discouraged some are if they are not trusted. The phrase, "Don't you trust me?" is frequently heard with an undertone of sadness or complaint. Sometimes children or teenagers ask their parents, "Don't you trust me?" when the parents place some restrictions on them, perhaps in connection with leisure time activities. Parents do that because they love you, young ones, and want to prevent any spiritual or physical harm befalling you. If you cooperate, you will see that parents will gradually trust you ever more and grant you more liberty to you. You can prove to them that you are trustworthy. In the world, many people are not trustworthy. Since we are living in the time of the end, and the demons are desperate and have influenced many people, we have to admit that trusting in everybody is not wise. Many trusted in religion and were disappointed. Others trusted in governments or the United Nations, but they were disappointed. They trusted political leaders that made all kinds of promises but did not keep all of them. Some politicians even were exposed as being liars. Proverbs 14:15 says, "The naive person believes every word, but the shrewd one ponders each step." If somebody, even in the truth, promises us big monetary returns if we give him money for his planned investment, we need to be careful and not believe every word. Some that spent their money were in for a disappointment when they learned that everything was lost. We also should not trust everything we read in newspapers or see on television. There's another thing we should not trust in: riches. Psalm 49:6 speaks about those who are trusting in their wealth and who boast about their great riches. Trusting in riches often leads to disappointment. "The one trusting in his riches will fall," says Proverbs 11:28. It is not wrong to be rich, just do not trust in riches. Riches are a risk factor. Many people today are dishonest and cheat. Some business owners have installed cameras at the workplace since they do not trust their employees to put in a full day of work. They know that some would play video games during work hours. But Jehovah created us with the inclination to trust. We can especially trust our spiritual brothers. True, once in a while such trust is misplaced. A few commit serious sins and have to be disfellowshipped, but that is rare. Jehovah himself is the best example of trusting in others. He trusted the Logos to faithfully cooperate with him as the master worker in creating the universe, the earth, and all the living things on earth, including mankind. What tremendous trust Jehovah showed in Jesus when he sent him to the earth. Jehovah trusted that Jesus would remain faithful and redeem mankind so that his will and purpose with mankind and the earth could be accomplished. Jehovah trusted him so much that he arranged for prophecies to be written that foretold that he would die faithfully. This trust on the part of Jehovah was not a risk. It was based on the collaboration between the two for eons of time. Think of the prophecy in Psalm 16:10, "For you will not leave me in the grave." Jesus had free will. This means that theoretically, he could have sinned. If he could not have sinned, Satan would probably not have tried three times to tempt Jesus to sin. If Jesus could not have sinned, why would he be so heavily distressed in the Garden of Gethsemane that he was sweating blood? Why send an angel to comfort and strengthen him if he could not sin or fail anyway? No question. Jesus felt the unfathomable load on his shoulders to remain faithful, since not only the salvation of mankind depended on him, but also the vindication of Jehovah's sovereignty. He did not want to disappoint Jehovah. Jesus used his own free will and was determined to stay loyal. How glad we are that he did. On the other hand, Jesus also trusted Jehovah completely. He trusted Jehovah that he would resurrect him if he would die faithfully. Actually, Jesus was publicly known to trust in Jehovah. People that passed by when he was on the torture stake were saying, "He has put his trust in God. Let him now rescue him if he wants him. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" Another example of trust was Abraham. When God told him to kill his beloved son Isaac, Abraham was willing to do so. He trusted that Jehovah could resurrect him. Hebrews 11:19 says, "He reasoned that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, and he did receive him from there in an illustrative way." 1 Corinthians 13:7 says that love believes all things. Love trusts that prophecies will come true. It also believes what our brothers tell us. It also helps to grant others the benefit of the doubt if a matter could be interpreted in different ways. Yes, trusting others is an expression of love. If you love somebody, you only assume and think the best of him. Another example of trust in Jehovah was Moses. He led the nation of Israel out of Egypt into the desert, a nation of upwards of 3 million people, and they had flocks of cattle and sheep with them. When he left Egypt, did he know how to provide these great crowds with water in the desert? Did he know what they would be eating after the initial foodstuffs that they took out of Egypt would run out? Did he know in advance that Jehovah would miraculously provide the manna? It doesn't seem so. But he trusted that Jehovah would take care of the people. The three friends of Daniel were another fine example of trust. They did not bow and worship in front of an idol that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. They were told they would be thrown into a fiery furnace if they disobeyed. They remained firm and were protected by an angel, so the fire did not do any harm to them. After that, Nebuchadnezzar then declared, "Praised be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and went against the command of the king and were willing to die rather than serve or worship any god except their own God." As we are getting ever closer to the Great Tribulation, we might be confronted with scary challenges and tests related to nationalism. Will we keep trusting Jehovah? We trust we will. Jehovah will miraculously save his people throughout the Great Tribulation and arrange for their survival. Today, the faithful slave was put in charge of providing spiritual food for God's people who number into the millions. The slave also shows complete trust in Jehovah that he will guide them with his Holy Spirit. What makes it possible for the faithful and discreet slave to provide precious spiritual food? I will give you insight and instruct you in the way you should go, says Jehovah, Psalm 32, verse 8. Today, Jehovah provides direction to the slave through Jesus. Jesus, in turn, provides direction for his people through the faithful and discreet slave. We can have, therefore, full confidence in the scriptural insight, understanding, and guidance. Satan tries to sow mistrust. Under communist dictatorship in Romania, secret police officers forced a responsible brother to walk with them on a heavily frequented street, hoping that other brothers would see this and wrongly conclude that this brother works with the secret police. Did the scheme work out? No. It failed. Brothers did see him, but kept trusting him. We learn that we should not quickly lose trust in our brothers. Satan also has the scheme to spread rumors about faithful brothers, including the faithful slave. The method of spreading rumors is not new. When Jesus was resurrected and the tomb was empty, the soldiers that reported it were told to spread the rumor that the disciples came and stole the body at night. Matthew 28:15 relates, "So they took the silver pieces and did as they were instructed, and this story has been spread abroad among the Jews up to this very day." Another rumor in the first century was that Christians were responsible for the great fire of Rome. Could such accusation be true? Historians say that it was Nero, the emperor, who set fire to the city. Today, rumors are occasionally being spread in electronic form about the faithful slave. This has caused some concern on the part of some brothers, especially when the reports are commenting on court cases where some in the organization were accused. Sometimes reference is made to certain quotes, and readers then think, how can a quote be a rumor? A quote can be taken out of context. Critical reports often give only part of a matter and leave out other aspects. Often such rumors play on the emotions. Ask yourself, am I prone to believe rumors? And even if I am, should I spread it and undermine the trust that others have in the slave or in representative of the branch office? Avoid sensationalism by saying something like, can you believe what I heard about this matter, or this person, or that person, referring to a statement that may have appeared on Facebook, YouTube, or Twitter. The spread of rumors is like wildfire that is hard to control. It spreads distrust and can undermine someone's faith. This is not to say that the slave is perfect and never makes mistakes, but Jehovah and Jesus trust the imperfect slave who cares for things to the best of his ability and with the best of motives. Shouldn't we then trust the imperfect slave as well? To appreciate the extent of Jehovah's and Jesus' trust in the faithful slave, reflect on what he has promised its members. He has promised them immortality and incorruption. Soon, just before Armageddon, the remaining members of the slave will be taken to heaven. Since 1919 of our common era, the slave has been put in charge of some belongings of Christ, According to Matthew 24:47, when the anointed are taken to heaven, Jesus will at that point entrust all his belongings to them. Does this not reveal immense trust? Revelation 4:4 describes these resurrected anointed as co-rulers with Christ. Revelation 22:5 says they will rule not only for 1,000 years, but forever and ever. What immense trust Jesus shows toward them. Since Jehovah God and Jesus Christ completely trust the faithful and discreet slave, should we not do the same? Many servants of Jehovah in the past showed trust in Jehovah when confronted with obstacles or opposition. We can trust that Jehovah will not let us be tested beyond what we can bear, but will provide a way out so we can remain faithful under trials. So, whom do you trust? You fully trust in Jehovah, Jesus, and the faithful slave. To a reasonable degree, you also trust all your fellow brothers and sisters. The writer of Psalm 119:42 mentions something else we need to trust in, God's Word. He wrote, "For I put my trust in your Word." The prophecies in God's Word have always come true at the proper time. Based on that, we can trust fully that the remaining prophecies pointing to the survival of the Great Tribulation and to the paradise to follow will also come true without the slightest possibility of failure. Of course, we should trust not only Jehovah, Jesus, the faithful slave, and the Bible, but also our fellow brothers. The Apostle Paul is a fine example of this. He wrote in Philemon, or to Philemon, asking him to kindly receive back the runaway slave, Onesimus, that had become a brother. Paul wrote in Philemon 21, "I'm confident that you will comply, so I'm writing you, knowing that you will do even more than what I say." When we speak of trust, we sometimes think of a little child walking hand in hand with his father. The child does not question where the father will take him. The child trusts the father. All throughout the last days, true Christians have faced hostility of so many in the world. How strengthening Jehovah's promise is in view of the impending attack by Satan's hordes. When they attack, Jehovah's people will seem as defenseless, but we do not need to quake with fear. We trust that Jehovah, Jesus, and the angels will fight to deliver us. We will not shrink back in fear. In Hebrews 10:39, Paul wrote, "Now we are not the sort who shrink back to destruction, but the sort who have faith for the preserving of our lives." Today and after Armageddon, all can say according to Psalm 26:1 and 52:8, "I have trusted in Jehovah without wavering. My trust is in God's loyal love forever and ever." Therefore, keep trusting in Jehovah and those who are proving loyal to Him. I'd like to talk about a very common expression in the Bible. The expression is, "I am with you." 13 times it's attributed to a statement from Jehovah. 3 times it's something that Jesus said to one or more of his disciples. Of course, there are dozens of other times that the same sentiment is expressed using similar wording. Few things in the world equal the joy humans experience than the birth of a child. As children grow up, they are sometimes exposed to situations that tend to cause nervousness or even fear. So a parent may occasionally feel compelled to reassure a child, "Have no fear, I am with you." Jehovah loves his servants as if they were his children. Likewise, at John 13:1, Jesus' feelings for his disciples are well expressed. There it says, Jesus, having loved his own who were in the world, loved them to the end. So when we face fears, trials, or causes for anxiety, both our Heavenly Father and his Son, Jesus, reassuringly say, I am with you. Think of the righteous man Noah. Genesis 6:9 says that Noah walked with the true God. There's no doubt that Jehovah was with Noah. He preserved him and his family through the flood. Afterward, Jehovah further proved he was with Noah. In Genesis chapter 9, Jehovah said, I am now establishing my covenant with you. Never again will all flesh be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Jehovah could have made that determination and promised himself that he wouldn't do that again. But instead, he reached out to Noah and reassured him that he was with him by making the rainbow covenant with Noah and his offspring. Using similar terminology, Jehovah indicated that he was with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, and Gideon. They were all individuals that Jehovah was pleased with, so he reassured them he was with them. How about a group of people? Is Jehovah moved to feel the same way toward a large crowd of his servants collectively? Please find with me Exodus 6, verse 6 and 7. The whole nation of Israel was experiencing severe trials and suffering as slaves in Egypt. Notice Jehovah's reassurance to the vast number of people. Verses 6 and 7 state, Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am Jehovah, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians and rescue you from their slavery, and I will reclaim you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. And I will take you in as my people, and I will be your God, and you will certainly know that I am Jehovah your God, who is bringing you out from under the burdens of Egypt. If that great mixed group of people would follow his leadings, he said he'd take them in. He would be their God. What was he saying? He was reassuring them, I will be with you. And he was. For 40 years in the wilderness, he was with them, feeding them, providing water for them, ensuring their clothes and sandals would not wear out, protecting them from poisonous snakes, and so forth. And later, when entering the land of promise, he protected them during enemy warfare. Jehovah promised to be with and to support the kings of Israel as long as they heeded his commandments and direction. King Solomon was told, Jehovah, your God, will not desert you or abandon you, but he will be with you. King Asa was informed, Jehovah is with you as long as you remain with him. When faced with overwhelming enemy forces, King Jehoshaphat was told, Tomorrow go out against them, and Jehovah will be with you. Jehovah also proved to be with the many prophets that he sent out in his name. Just one example is Jeremiah. Imagine if you had Jeremiah's assignment. Suppose you had been directed to deliver a scathing denunciation and judgment against wicked kings, corrupt priests, and false prophets. How would you feel? Underqualified? Would you feel like a little child challenging a whole group of evil grown-ups? Notice how Jeremiah felt as he expressed himself at Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 6. But I said, Alas, O sovereign Lord Jehovah, I do not know how to speak, for I'm just a boy. What were Jehovah's reassuring words in reply? Jeremiah 1, 8 and 9. Do not be afraid because of their appearance, for I am with you to save you, declares Jehovah. Then Jehovah stretched out his hand and touched my mouth. And Jehovah said to me, I have put my words in your mouth. If Jehovah put the words that you were to say in your mouth, you'd no longer feel like a little child, would you? We don't think of Jeremiah as being an incredible Superman. He was a human like us. It's of interest that, though Jeremiah lived in another time and place, he faced situations similar to those we face. We interact with different types of people in our daily life, at work and at school. Some of them can be intimidating. And like Jeremiah, Jehovah has commissioned us to go to strangers and preach. We share the good news of the kingdom. Some are interested, others are just plain apathetic. But at times we may come across someone who is angry and may even be threatening. This is the time to remember Jeremiah. Though initially timid, he courageously faced the challenge of an intimidating response. How did he rally to the occasion? It was because Jehovah had reassured him, I am with you. He said, I've put my words in your mouth. Does Jehovah do something similar for us? Yes. Long after Jeremiah and the other faithful ones that were recorded in the Hebrew Scriptures came and went, Jehovah has proved to be with true Christians, both past and present. Find with me John chapter 8. Think of Jesus. It's true he was a perfect man, but did Jehovah leave him all alone? At John 8:16, what did Jesus himself say? And yet even if I do judge, my judgment is truthful, because I am not alone, but the Father who sent me is with me. We might be thinking of that intimidating person in the ministry. Even if you are facing the person without a fellow witness standing beside you, are you really all alone? Jesus knew that at the most stressful and emotionally draining time during his human life, his disciples would leave him all alone. But was he really alone? Let's read the inspired account at John 16:32. Again, these are Jesus' own words. Look, the hour is coming, indeed it has come, when each one of you will be scattered to his own house, and you will leave me alone. But I am not alone, because the Father is with me. Jesus was not alone during his most anxious moments. Jehovah was with him. If you think you are alone standing at the door of an irritated householder, think again. Jehovah is with you. You have more with you than if you had your whole congregation standing in the person's front yard. Well, why did Jesus share this precious insight with us? Look at the next verse. Jesus explains his reason for saying what he did. John 16, 33. I have said these things to you so that by means of me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take courage, I have conquered the world. We thank Jesus for addressing our fears and concerns when giving a witness. Instead of trembling with fear, he shared his confidence in Jehovah's support so that we may have peace. He acknowledged that we would face tribulation, but he said we could look at his example. and have courage to deal with the tribulation. Why? Jesus said in verse 32, it was because the Father was with him. Do you recall that Jehovah told Jeremiah, I have put my words in your mouth? Can Jehovah do the same for us when we are opposed by unbelievers? The Christian Greek scriptures answer with a resounding yes. Please follow along with the reading of the book of Mark, chapter 13. And please notice that the setting Jesus describes is the ministry, preaching the good news. Maybe you've had a good morning in service, but then you take one more door. The person is irate and even calls the police. What should you do? What will you say when the police arrive? You don't have to be overly concerned. Why not? Because, similar to Jeremiah, Jehovah will, in effect, put his words in your mouth. Mark 13, 10 and 11 says, also, in all the nations, the good news has to be preached first. And when they are taking you to hand you over, do not be anxious beforehand about what to say. But whatever is given you in that hour, say this, for you are not the ones speaking, but the Holy Spirit is. By this, do we mean that Jehovah will miraculously put words in your mouth for you to say? Not necessarily. Did you notice verse 11 said that the Holy Spirit is the one speaking? You've been taught the basis for your faith from the scriptures, and you know the reason that you teach the Bible's message. That's all stored in your mind. So what's the Holy Spirit's role when we are in an intimidating situation, when sharing the good news? Jehovah is with you. He uses his Holy Spirit to bring to the surface some of those precious gems that might be buried in your mind. You may be amazed at what you remember when put under pressure by the authorities or even by outright opposers. In this way, Jehovah is with you. Add to the fact that Jesus is with you in the disciple-making work. Let's be reminded of this very encouraging thought at Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Jesus was discussing our commission to preach, teach, and make disciples. And how does he conclude the Bible book of Matthew? Let's read Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Go, therefore, and make disciples of people of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things I've commanded you. And look, I am with you all the days until the conclusion of the system of things. Jesus said that he is with us now when we are making disciples and teaching people the truth. And he promises he'll support us in this important work until the end of this wicked system of things. As prophesied, during this time of the conclusion of the system, we are being persecuted in different areas of the world. As the scriptures show, Satan and his angels are misleading the entire inhabited earth. Recently, Jehovah's people have been persecuted in Russia. But will the persecution succeed in eliminating true worship in that area of the world? No. Why not? It's because Jehovah is with them. He and Jesus promised, I am with you. Russia did not learn from the past. It will prove to be the same for them as it was for Nazi Germany under Hitler. Hitler thought his regime could eradicate true worship and God's people from areas under their control, but they made a big mistake. While it is true they murdered some 2,000 brothers, in the end, the scheme ended up in failure. Why? Because God was with us, not with them. God with us? Those words have decorated national emblems and even the uniforms of soldiers of Prussia and the Tsarist Russian Empire. These words were also on the belts of German troops when they marched into Belgium in the year 1914 of our common era. But they had it wrong. The Sovereign Lord Jehovah was with us, not with them. He's with all of us now. He'll be with us during Armageddon. He'll be with us after Armageddon. He'll be with us at the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ. He'll be with mankind at the end of 100,000 years. He'll be with humans at the end of 100 million years and at the end of 100 million years times 100 million years. Jehovah will be with mankind forever, and so will Jesus. They are both on record as saying, I am with you.
We've been looking forward to hearing from our visiting speaker, Brother Gerrit Losch, again. He will now address us with the final topic for our special assembly day, Be Molded by the Great Potter. Brother Losch.
So our subject is Molded by the Great Potter. Well, my wife and I have a nice vessel from Romania that we got as a gift, somebody gave us, and it looks just beautiful, the work of an artist. And some vases are very valuable, for example, those from the Chinese Ming dynasty. Cost a lot of money. They're worth a lot. Now, and for millenniums, the society, human society, has depended on pottery for all kinds of things: cups, plates, cooking pots, storage jars, decorative vases, and usually made from clay. That's the basic material of pottery, and it has characteristics like, for instance, it's plastic, can be molded, and will retain the shape, and it hardens if you fire it. Becomes virtually indestructible. Firing also protects the clay body against the effects of water. If a sun-dried clay vessel is filled with water, it will eventually collapse. But if it is heated, chemical changes that begin to take place around about 900 degrees Fahrenheit preclude a return to the plastic state, no matter how much water is later put in it. When feldspar or soapstone is added to the clay and exposed to an even higher temperature, 2,000 to 2,600 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's quite hot, then the product becomes translucent and is known as porcelain. But porcelain comes from clay. And many of us have porcelain in their homes. So it's made from clay of the ground. And so is man, made originally from clay from the ground, as the Bible says. And God told Adam that he is from dust. But what a wonderful work Jehovah created from the dust or the clay from the ground, didn't he? And in Job 33:6, remember the words of Elihu to Job, figuratively speaking, he said, to quote him, "From clay I was shaped too." See? The monetary value of materials constituting the human body is negligible. A chemist said that 65% of our body consists in oxygen, 18% of carbon, 10% of hydrogen, 3% of nitrogen, 1.5% calcium, 1% phosphorus, and the rest of other elements. And if that's put together in its value separately, it doesn't amount to a lot of cost or expense. But Jehovah put it all together in a wonderful, miraculous way. And so the human body has an inestimable value and level. Nobody else than Jehovah could have done that. Although we have little choice in how our genetic makeup shapes our physical body, we inherited certain features, and sometimes as hard as we try, we cannot change much. But we can change as far as our spiritual makeup is concerned. And the theme of our special assembly day emphasizes God's authority as a potter, and different speakers have emphasized that the shaping is for our attitude and for our conduct. In Romans 9:21, Paul says, "Does not the potter have authority over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel of an honorable use, another for a dishonorable one?" The emphasis is on the authority of Jehovah God. But does Jehovah, with his authority, arbitrarily mold us into what he wants us to be? Well, earlier it was brought out in one talk that Jehovah never forces us to do anything against our will. And that's how we differ from clay. See, because clay cannot resist and is passive, yeah? It all depends on the potter. But we are not, in that sense, we are not like the clay. What we are going to be, what type of vessels we decide, it depends on how much we let Jehovah mold us. And if Jehovah would force us in one way or another, and that's a big theory in Protestantism, the predestination, and of course in other religions too, like in Islam, predestination, but if that would be the case, it would be all something automatic, routine, and it would take away one thing that's so valuable: love. See, if we are programmed to do things or to be a certain way, then we would not act out of love. To act out of love, we need to have a free will. Anything, even if it's good, if it's not out of love, it doesn't really count. Just as an illustration, there's some men that rarely give roses to their wives, and I'm sure there's nobody here in this audience that would apply that, but just suppose in the world, you know, there's such a man, and so a friend sees it, and he feels sorry for the wife, never gets roses, so he says, "Well, now you go with me to a flower shop and buy roses for your wife." And the man doesn't want to. So his friend pulls a gun and makes him go with him at gunpoint to the flower shop. So he goes, he buys the roses, gives the bouquet to his wife. Is it a good thing to give roses? Yes, but if the wife later finds out how she got the roses, it wouldn't mean anything to her, would it? Because it was not out of love, but it was forced. And same is with Jehovah. He could force us, he has the authority, he is almighty, but he doesn't force us, because he wants us to serve him out of love. And so in that sense, we are completely different from clay. We have a free will. Now, Jehovah God, talking about this predestination thing, does Jehovah not know everything? Does he not know how we are going to be in the future? Well, if he wanted to know, he could. But he decided he doesn't want to know. He wants to leave it up to us, what will happen to us. He decided what will be happening with the world and world events and mankind in general, because his will is going to certainly come true. Nobody can stop that. But our individual future, yeah, that's not, Jehovah has not decided to know that. But does it take away from Jehovah's omniscience that he decided not to know what's going to happen with us? No. And we can compare it to his almightiness. Is Jehovah almighty? Everybody will agree to that. Even worldly people that believe in God. Does Jehovah have the power, if a man was just going to commit a crime, just like killing somebody with a gun, would Jehovah have the power to just take the gun away from him or make him drop the gun or whatever, to smash it out of his hand? Could Jehovah do that with every criminal? There's no question. He has the power to do that. But he decided not to do it because he gave free will to humankind and decided not to intervene in all these cases. And so that doesn't take away from his being almighty. He's still almighty, although he chooses not to intervene every time. And the same is with his omniscience. The fact that he desists from wanting to know our individual destiny and leaves it up to us, it depends how we react, what will happen to us, that doesn't take away from his being all knowledgeable, knowing all things. It's just because he chooses not to. But he could, if he would like to. So we should not think that it takes away anything from Jehovah's qualities. Certainly, it is loving if we let ourselves be molded by Jehovah God, isn't it? And we have an interesting comment by the Apostle Paul in connection with being molded, in connection with vessels. In Romans chapter 9, starting verse 11, and it says here, talking about Jacob and Esau, for when they had not been born nor had practiced anything good or vile, in order that the purpose of God respecting the choosing might continue dependent not upon works but upon the one who calls. Again, it emphasizes Jehovah's authority to decide whom he wants to give privileges. And mentioning Esau and Jacob here in the context before, Paul used that just as an illustration because actually he was talking about the choosing for heavenly life. So we have to read these words in that, with that in mind, the purpose of God respecting the choosing, who is going to be anointed, or choosing in connection with the royal priesthood, might depend not upon works. One cannot, through a lot of Bible study or a lot of preaching, kind of upgrade his status and then cause Jehovah to call him for the royal priesthood. No, the Bible says it doesn't depend on someone's works. But on what does it depend? It depends upon the one who calls. Jehovah, he knows why he calls some and not others. Sometimes it may be a puzzle. Even for the ones being called, they wonder, why did he call me and not somebody else? But Jehovah knows why. We don't know. And it's his decision. And then in verse 14 he says, what shall we say then? Is there injustice with God? No, because he can call whom he wants. Not injustice. Let us illustrate it for even for the children to understand. If I have a big cake, yeah, and there's a few children, and I give half of the children, I give a piece of my cake, and the other half of the children don't get a piece, am I unjust? Not really. Because I can do with my cake what I want. I can eat it all alone, and I'm still not unjust if I eat it all alone. I can decide whom I want to give a piece of cake and whom not. And so Jehovah decides whom he calls for the heavenly calling and whom not. And he's never unjust. It's up to him whom he wants to give this undeserved privilege. So he says then here in connection, in verse 15, for he says to Moses, I will have mercy upon whomever I will have mercy, and I show compassion upon whomever I show compassion. So then it depends not upon the one wishing, nor upon the one running, but upon God, who has mercy. And so if somebody wishes to go to heaven, that does not cause Jehovah to call him to heaven, just because somebody wishes or runs hard to try to obtain it. No, it says it does not depend on the one wishing, nor upon the one running. It's Jehovah's decision. He sees something in a person that makes him call the person for that privilege. And then in verse 17, he again emphasizes his own power as he has displayed it in connection with Pharaoh. And we've just commented that also in the Watchtower study, the power display that Jehovah exercised against this haughty man. And that my name, he ends here in verse 17, may be declared in all the earth. So then upon whom he wishes, he has mercy. Upon whom he wishes, he lets become obstinate. And so back in those days, a figurative application was that the Israelites, the people, were the ones that were vessels of mercy. And Jehovah had mercy on them, being oppressed by the Egyptian, and he liberated them by means of the Exodus. But then the Egyptians, what were they? Well, we continue reading in Romans chapter 9. It says, O man, who then really are you, verse 20, to be answering back to God, shall the thing molded say to him that's molded, why did you make me this way? What does not the potter have authority over the clay to make from the same lump of vessel one for an honorable use, another for a dishonorable use? If now God, although having the will to demonstrate his wrath and to make his power known, like against the Egyptians, tolerated with much long-suffering vessels of wrath made fit for destruction, in order that he might make known the riches of his glory upon vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory, namely us. So Paul uses this illustration and then applies it to his days and the calling, to the heavenly calling, to become vessels prepared for glory. Namely, he says, us whom he called not only from the Jews, but also from among the nations, like the Romans to whom he just wrote. So what of it, he says. And then he quotes from a prophet to show that even those who were not his people then will become his people and spiritual sons of God. So in the times of Paul, the vessels of mercy were those called to heavenly hope. And the Jews that resisted Jesus, they were the vessels of wrath. But that has also prophetic application to us today. Again, the vessels of mercy are the anointed. It's not all Christians, it's the anointed Christians, where Paul says, God has prepared us beforehand for glory. But the vessels of wrath are the nations that fight Jehovah and his king and the kingdom. And in Armageddon, at the final coming of Jesus Christ, he will destroy these vessels of wrath. They will be shattered like a potter smashes a vessel that he finds no use for. This was also prophesied in Psalm 2, yeah, prophetically. And one brother, I think, mentioned it in the morning program, quoting Psalm 2 with regard to Jesus smashing these vessels with reference to the governments of the world. We appreciate getting this understanding from the faithful and discreet slave, do we not? Now, we said that Satan is the great potter, but Satan... not a great, but a great potter. And of course, Jehovah is the greatest one, but Satan also is a potter because he tries to, as mentioned, squeeze people into his mold, as we've heard recently. And we can even say that parents are potters to an extent. Yeah? And we will talk a little bit about that further. And in Jeremiah 19, 10 and 11, this was mentioned also in the morning program, Jehovah said to Jeremiah, this is what Jehovah of Armies has said, the same way like this potter did, I shall break this people and this city, Jerusalem, as someone breaks the vessel of the potter, so that it is no more able to be repaired. And that happened to Jerusalem and the people back then. But Jerusalem of those days of Jeremiah, are a prophetic type of the people that claim to be in a covenant relationship with Jehovah and really are not. It's Christendom, apostate Christendom. And so they will have the same fate. Jehovah will break them to pieces at the beginning of the Great Tribulation by means of political entities. We will discuss three ways in which our great potter, Jehovah God, molds us. And number one is by his word, the Bible. Number two, by his Holy Spirit. And three, through the organization. And let's talk about point number one first. To be shaped in our thinking by means of God's word, the Bible. Certainly we want to cherish everything we read in God's word. And we also cherish reading the Bible daily, don't we? And in Psalm 119, we find this encouragement. 119. And starting in verse 12. This expresses appreciation for the Bible, does it not? Blessed are you, O Jehovah, teach me your regulations. And the regulations are in God's word. With my lips I have declared all the judicial decisions of your mouth. In the way of your reminders I have exalted. Okay, the reminders also are to be found in the Bible. Just as over all other valuable things, with your orders I will concern myself, and I will look to your paths. For your statutes, which we find in the Bible, I shall show a fondness. I shall not forget your word. So we say the Bible is God's word. And if we have fondness for God's word, we'll really try to get it down to our heart. In one of the Proverbs, Proverbs 19:8, the heart is emphasized. And let's look at this verse also. Proverbs 19:8 says, he that is acquiring heart is loving his own soul. To acquire heart, because our relationship to Jehovah, of course, is affected by our heart. But what does it mean to acquire heart, and what is the figurative heart? Because he was not talking about the literal organ, the literal heart. He was not talking about that. Well, the figurative heart stands for the so-called inside of a person, the so-called interior man or woman, which manifests itself in the person's activities, in his desires, in his affections, emotions, passions, purposes, his thoughts, perceptions, imaginations, wisdom, knowledge, skills, his beliefs, reasonings, his memory, and his consciousness. And that was explained this way in the Journal of the Society of Biblical Literature and Exegesis, or Exegesis. Well, these people understood that heart refers not only to the seat of emotions. That's not a complete understanding. It's just part of it. You remember Jesus once asked, when he performed a miracle, he asked the bystanders, what are you reasoning in your hearts? Are we reasoning with our organ? No. We are reasoning with our minds. So the figurative heart has to do with our mind also. It includes it. Our reasonings, our thinking. So it's very comprehensive, is it not? So Proverbs 19:8 says, he that is inquiring heart is loving his own soul, or does good to his own soul. He's a person that gives serious attention to what he is deep down, figuratively speaking only. And he uses his mind to acquire an accurate knowledge of the Bible. He meditates upon these things and seeks to apply them. He carefully molds his desires, affections, emotions, goals in life also. So we must scrutinize what we really are deep inside and allow Jehovah to mold us. How? By reading and meditating upon God's Word, the Bible. Now, who of you has been visiting Brooklyn headquarters sometime in the past? Who has? Well, I see a lot of hands go up. Yeah, probably 70% at least. And you remember what you probably have seen at one of the walls of the former printery that we've transferred to Wallkill, but the words are still there. And with big letters it says there, read God's Word, the Bible, from time to time. No? You're right. It doesn't say that. It says, read God's Word, the Bible, daily. Whom are we telling that? Are we encouraging our brothers to do that? Well, not with this text. We are encouraging people in the world to read the Bible daily, not just regularly, because regularly could be every other day. It's not enough to read the Bible every other day. We need to read the Bible daily. And that's what it says. And there's thousands of car drivers that pass by this building every day, and we encourage these people of the world to read the Bible daily. And by the way, a few months ago, a young, relatively young brother came to me and said that this text, when he drove by, caused curiosity in him, and he contacted the brothers and started to study. He came into the truth. And it was, the trigger was this text on this building. But now, if we tell other people that are not witnesses to read the Bible every day, what do you think? Shouldn't we also do it to be a good example? And you know what it means to read the Bible daily? It means to read the Bible daily. And that means no exceptions, no excuses. Yeah? The excuse would be, well, I'm too tired today. Yeah? That would be an excuse. Or to say, well, I'm too tired, then I read a little bit more the next day. No? Well, that's not daily Bible reading, you see. Daily Bible reading needs to be done every day. Like the Bereans did when Paul preached to them, remember in Acts chapter 17, it says that they daily, yeah, checked the Bible and read the Bible to see whether what Paul preached to them was really the Word of God or correct. Or look at another text, and that's one of the several we would be able to quote, but we don't have time. But Psalm 1, for instance, and it ties happiness to reading the Bible daily, when it says, Psalm 1 starts out, happy is the man or woman, and then go to verse 2, his delight is in the law of Jehovah, and in his law he reads in an undertone day and night. Now, that doesn't mean 24 hours, you know, that's logical, that it was not meant, but it meant every day, whether day or night, every day to read in God's Word. And if we love Jehovah, then certainly we will find the time, as in my home country this saying is, you always find the time for what you love. If we say we don't have the time, it's really an excuse. If we love Jehovah, we will make time. Yeah? And we have a very good example in some of our brothers that showed extraordinary appreciation for the Bible. I remember the life report of Brother Nasho Dori, who was Albanian, and he lived under the severe ban in Albania, atheist state. And in his life report, you can look it up in the search mode in the computer. You have the Watchtower Library on computer. Nasho Dori, D-O-R-I. He said that for 60 years until he lost his eyesight, he read in the Bible every day 1 hour. 1 hour every day for 60 years. Now, we are not asking that from you. Yeah, in our times with so many things to do and the stress, we are not asking that. But what about reading one chapter? What about reading maybe 10 minutes? Could you do that? What would be a good time to start? Not tonight, wouldn't it? Tonight, start with daily Bible reading. And Jehovah sees whether you do it or not. And don't you think that if Jehovah sees your effort, then he'll bless you even more? Now, there was a young 14-year-old publisher that was reading the Bible every day, and they interviewed him at an assembly day. And the brother asked him how he benefits from daily Bible reading, because he does it. Before I answer that, or go on with the experience, I would like to put it again as true or false. The main reason to read the Bible daily is to increase in our accurate knowledge of Jehovah and the truth. True or false? It sounds true, but it's not. It's false. The reason why we should read and meditate the Bible is not primarily the knowledge, no. You know what that young 14-year-old said in the interview? He said, if I read the Bible daily, it helps me to love Jehovah more. So why should you read the Bible daily? Because it affects your relationship with Jehovah. The Bible is His word. It's like a letter from a father. No matter how busy you are, wouldn't you take the time to read it? It increases your love for Jehovah. That's the reason why. The knowledge is a side effect. It's not the prime reason. So we certainly want to do that, and that will help us to be adjusted according to God's will, molded, shaped into how Jehovah wants us to be. And Romans chapter 12 speaks of it. In chapter 12, verse 2, and we've covered that text already once earlier this day, quit being fashioned after the system of things. But I want to emphasize the second part now of this text. It says, but be transformed by making your mind over, that you may prove to yourselves the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Transform. Now, for transformation, the Greek word is metamorphosis. And so similarly sounds the verb. And when we talk about this, because it's also a word that is used in English, we think of the metamorphosis that a caterpillar undergoes to become a beautiful butterfly. And we all love butterflies, don't we? So if you think about that, do you want to be like a caterpillar? You know, we don't like them too much to view them even or to touch them. Oh, you know, but what about a butterfly? See, and that's the difference. It's just an illustration that Paul makes in use in the choice of his words. When we get molded and change, make our minds and personality over, we become just like a beautiful butterfly. And we used to be like this creeping thing that we didn't like. The two words used in Greek is meta, which means or implies a change, and morphe, which means shape or form. And so we've been talking about that all day today. So we can choose what we want to be. Of course, we are also being shaped by our environment, by the things that we hear and see, our associations, our experiences in life. We encourage, therefore, to walk with wise persons, as Proverbs 13:20 says, he that's walking with wise persons will become wise, but he that's having dealings with the stupid ones will fare badly. So what kind of companions are we associating with in our leisure time? With wise persons or unwise persons of the world? Are we willing to let Jehovah mold us, or do we let the people in the world mold us? So, therefore, we want to keep all that in mind and continue with reading the Bible every day. The Bible warns us of wrong association. Now, some of our young people, they thought that they don't need to do that. And we have lost, very sadly, a number of teenagers to the world. Because, you see, we've said that Bible reading increases our love for Jehovah and the truth, but there's also the love of the world. And it's a battle between these two loves, the love of the world, the love of Jehovah. And the question is, which love will end up being stronger? And it's interesting, my observation is this, that of all the young people that left the truth, and frequently also their homes in connection with it, it's never the ones that read the Bible every day until they left. It's always the young people that do not read the Bible daily and meditate upon it. So, parents, if you want your teenagers to stay faithful in the truth, please insist that they read the Bible every day. Not only when they are young children, when they are baptized and 16 years old, 17 years old, insist that they read the Bible every day. But, of course, you've got to give a good example. If they would know that you don't do it, this encouragement wouldn't be very effective. But to get them to do it, why don't you sit down with them and read it, the Bible daily as a family? Maybe after the daily text discussion, just choose one chapter to read as a family. Or after a meal, read it in a circle. Let each one give a comment on a portion of what he's read. And get them to have this good habit. So then they will be able to resist Satan that wants to mold them, but they will then be molded by Jehovah. Now, what else helps us? The Holy Spirit helps us to resist the molding by the world. And we appreciate the Holy Spirit very much. We couldn't do without it. In connection with the literal vessels of clay, we said that they become resistant if they go through fire. How can we apply that in an illustrative way? Well, we have to go sometimes through fiery tests, problems in life. But if we have the Holy Spirit, it will help us to persevere, to endure hardships, testings. James 1, 2, and 3 assures us, consider it all joy, my brothers, when you meet with various trials, knowing as you do that this tested quality of your faith works out endurance. Who of us doesn't have any trials? See, no, I cannot see a single hand. The truth is, we all have some kind of trials. Be it at the workplace, be it in the family, be it wherever it may be. It doesn't always have to be opposition. Different trials could also be trial connection with our health and age. James said, when under trial, let no one say, I'm being tried by God. Because Jehovah doesn't do that, see? James says, nor does he himself try anyone in a negative sense, see? James 1, 13 and 14. And our trials may be many and varied, but as was the case with Job, they all play a part in our molding. What a grand assurance we have in James 5, 11, where James says, look, we pronounce happy those who have endured. You have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen the outcome that Jehovah gave, that Jehovah is very tender in affection and merciful. And who is here in the audience that have gone through more than Job? Nobody. You see, not only was his physical health affected and material possessions destroyed, but also he lost 10 children in one day. Nobody has experienced this suffering that Job has experienced. And Job didn't understand why this all happened to him. He actually erroneously thought that Jehovah causes it. But still, he did not give up his loyalty to Jehovah. And when he persevered, he came out as a man tested for his loyalty. And Jehovah did correct him for the wrong thought that he thought that, you know, it was Jehovah doing this. In reality, it was Satan doing this, bringing these trials upon him. But Jehovah rewarded him at the end. And if we are going through trials, don't think only of the present, but of the future. See, Job, when he is going to be resurrected, he had lost 10 children. He'll get the 10 children back. But after his test back in ancient times, he had 10 additional children, and they will also be resurrected in the new world. So Job will have 20 children. And you see that Jehovah always gives a good outcome if we just endure our trials. And Jehovah never causes it. It's good to have that in mind. He allows it to happen, but he doesn't cause it. And the matter with Job was not just about Job, because Satan claimed to Jehovah, as we read in the book of Job, yeah, everything a man has, he will give in behalf of his soul. He didn't say everything Job has, he'll give in behalf of his soul. A man, he tied in all mankind. Every man has, every person has his price, he said, you know, and he's wrong. Because true Christians and servants of Jehovah at different times always were willing to die for the truth, for being loyal to Jehovah God. They did not allow any price to be put on them to escape death. Well, Satan provoked Jehovah God and said, stretch his hand out against Job. But Jehovah did not accept this challenge. In return, Jehovah said to Satan, see, he is in your hand. Satan wanted the calamities to come from Jehovah's hand. No, but Jehovah doesn't do anything bad. But he permitted it to come through Satan's hand. So, not Jehovah doesn't do anything. And so whenever we should have a thought, if we have difficulties, problems, or trials, why does Jehovah, you know, permit that to come upon me? Well, he has reasons, and if we stick it out, we can prove Satan a liar. What a privilege we have to go through trials and proving Satan a liar and vindicating Jehovah God. So also it makes us feel feeling more compassion for others that are suffering. So there's good connected with trials, with more empathy for others. We can prove that we have right motives and love for Jehovah. Peter acknowledged this also when he said, in this fact you're greatly rejoicing, though for a little while at present, if it must be, you have been grieved by various trials, in order that the tested quality of your faith, much greater value than gold that perishes, may be found a cause for praise and glory and honor to Jehovah God at the revelation of Christ Jesus. So what a privilege we have, by remaining faithful under trials, to praise Jehovah, give him glory and honor. So there are spiritual benefits with going through trials. Now let's talk a little bit about molding our young ones. And the parents are potters in that respect, as we've mentioned. And there are many forces at work molding the hearts of our children in the world. And so parents have to put forth extra effort in this time of the end to reach the hearts of the children. And from small on, teaching them how to pray. And when they start going to school, teaching them. But even before that, so they are able to resist temptations and ridicule and worldly things like pornography and drug abuse and so on. And Paul said to Timothy that he should flee from the desires incidental to youth. What did he mean, incidental to youth? Well, he meant incidental to youth in the world. From these desires he should flee as a young man, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, along with those who call upon the Lord out of a clean heart. Along with those means having association only with those in the truth. A number of parents have lost their children to the world, and sometimes the reason was neglecting to study with them. They may only have a very superficial family study once a week, but that's not enough. But then other parents put forth a lot more efforts and still lost the children to the world. And if they did all they could spiritually, they should not accuse themselves of being a failure in raising the children, because didn't that happen to Jehovah also? Some of his children, angelic children, spirit sons, angels, they became demons. Was it Jehovah's fault? No. It was because the free will is given. And it was also free will given to the spirit sons of God. So we have parents that have done everything imaginable to raise the children in the truth, and they still left the truth. And that's just because the children when they grow up, they have a free will. And so we should not accuse ourselves. But on the other hand, if we do still have children in our home, we should make sure that we really do all we can. And what is included in that? Well, we've mentioned the family study every week. But a family study where everybody sits in, even those who don't go to school yet, because it promotes the family spirit, this unity. What is needed in addition? A regular Bible study with the children individually. If there's two children, it's not a problem. The father can study with the older one or the boy. The mother can have a Bible study with the younger one or the girl. Now, if there's four children or more, well, then maybe we have to group them in two groups, the older and the younger. But the idea is, it's good for them to have a Bible study in addition to the family study, where sometimes anyway, even the head of the family prepares himself at the same time for some meeting, book study or watchtower study. That's not enough. A Bible study with the children. So the question is, do we take the time for our children? You see, it's so important. Some parents excuse they're not taking enough time by saying, but the time I spent with my children, it's quality time. But that's an excuse. It's not the right attitude to have for Christian parents. Christian parents just need to spend time with the children. Also, of course, leisure time and in field service and so on. But the personal Bible study with the children, that's so important, because what the parents should study then is what the children just need. For instance, some parents may have a 7-year-old and a 12-year-old. Do they need the same spiritual food? Probably not. So the parents should study something with the younger child, what the younger child needs, and things it has to contend with. And maybe with a 12-year-old, something else. And if there's a 17-year-old boy that is baptized in the household, well, the father should study with his baptized boy, but that boy may need something else again. And you see why the family study is not enough, where everybody covers the same material. It doesn't really apply and address the needs of the individual children. So if you love your children, please start studying with them aside from family study. Have a personal Bible study with them. And as we mentioned earlier, teach them to read the Bible every day and meditate upon it. Then it's also important to pray to Jehovah God. And if we pray, then we are in the right frame of mind to be molded by Jehovah. Usually we express our prayers with an attitude of humility. In Romans chapter 8, 26-29, Paul makes an interesting comment about prayers. Romans 8, 26-27 says, "In like manner, the Spirit also joins in with help for our weakness. For the problem of what we should pray for as we need to, we do not know sometimes. But the Spirit itself pleads for us with groanings unuttered. Yet he who searches the hearts knows what the meaning of the Spirit is, or spiritual attitude that we have, because it is pleading in accord with God for holy ones." Yeah, sometimes we may even have a hard time to pray. And we have troubles, we don't know what to say. And Jehovah knows what is in our hearts. And he accepts prayers that others have uttered that we find in the Bible as if we have expressed these prayers. But it is good to kind of exercise self-control and try to get going with praying, and praying loud if we are alone, because it helps us to concentrate and focus on Jehovah God. The Bible says we need to pray with Holy Spirit, and praying certainly reflects a proper heart attitude. Now, we also mentioned that we are being molded through Jehovah's organization, and what comes to mind is the services of the faithful and discreet slave class, the anointed remnant still on earth, and these represented by the governing body. Matthew 24:45-47, some of you can quote that by heart. Says, "Who really is the faithful and discreet slave whom his master appointed over his domestics to give them their food at the proper time? Happy is that slave if his master on arriving finds him doing so." Doing what? Giving out food, not food kitchen, you know, spiritual food. "Truly I say to you, he will appoint him over all his belongings." So there would be two appointments, one at Pentecost 33, initial appointment, and then if Jesus would return at that time of his return, if the faithful slave would give out spiritual food, he would appoint him now even over more things than before. But it speaks here of giving out food at the proper time. And not only to the domestics, the individual anointed, but also to the belongings, which recently the Watchtower study article showed, the great crowd is part of these belongings. So everybody benefits from that spiritual food, and don't we appreciate that? And the brothers in general showed a willing attitude to apply the counsel that comes through the faithful slave. Do you want to hear a few examples? Yeah. For instance, in December 1, 2004, in the Watchtower, the counsel was given, in view of the sanctity of life, it is best for a person not to drink alcoholic beverages at all when he or she has to drive. Yeah, and so it's fine to note that some brothers, that when they went to a restaurant and they had a glass of wine with a meal, and then they used to just sit in the car and drive home, after reading that, they changed. They were willing to be molded. Because the faithful slave said not to drink alcohol at all if you have to drive after that. You see? So that means zero glass of wine, zero beer, if you have to drive after the meal, but have a designated driver. So brothers were willing to accept this and change their life, because many had the custom in the past to go to a restaurant, drink wine, and still drive home. Another point, as an example, we had sometimes questions from readers and other balanced comments on exercising self-control in connection with obesity and gluttony. And the Watchtower made this balanced expression, says, gluttony is not determined by someone's size, but by his attitude toward food. A person may be of normal size or may even be thin and yet be a glutton. It's sometimes doesn't look fair, you know. Some persons can eat and eat and eat and they're still slim. And another one, he says, I just eat very little and doesn't seem fair. So the Watchtower said this, what is the Bible's counsel to avoid excessive eating, especially, or why is this counsel especially important today? Because particularly regarding our day, Jesus warned, and then it quotes Luke chapter 21, we can read that from the Bible. Luke 21, speaking of our days, said this in verse 34. And I quote part of this verse. It says, but pay attention to yourselves in the time of the end, that your hearts never become weighed down with overeating. Interesting. Jesus knew so long time ago that there would be a problem with overeating in the time of the end. And so he, speaking of the time of the end, he warned his disciples, said, pay attention that you are not weighed down with overeating. So it's not the size of a person that determines that, because some have problems with the, forgot that word, thyroid. Yeah, and other problems. But the investigation showed that most, for most, the reason is overeating. And so kindly counsel was given to exercise self-control. And as Paul said, especially elders and ministerial servants, Paul said to Timothy, should be moderate in habits. And that includes being moderate in eating habits. Then again, some of the brothers that used to go to college, they got counsel, and the parents, as far as the children is concerned. And we've talked about this morning. And it's even interesting that some interested persons that only had maybe 6 months to finish their college education, when they learned the truth, they quit college. They didn't want to spend even a few more months there. Wanted to put kingdom interest first. The trust in Jehovah, that he would care for them. And so we have good examples. Everybody has to decide for himself, but we certainly see that many who read what the faithful slave wrote about college education have applied it. It's good. And if parents allow their children to go to college with that in view, that they earn more money to have a better life materially, it could even cost the father's privilege as an elder if he allows it, and if that is the reason why he allows it. So it is not to be taken lightly. And there's other things that where we got counsel, for instance, in connection with violent sports. And some that used to watch violent sports now have stopped, although for some it wasn't easy to stop. For instance, only a few years ago, 2002, June 1 issue of the Watchtower said this, June 1, 2002, page 17. Everybody should ask himself, it says there, do I find the popular but violent sports merely tasteless, or do I feel tormented as Lot did by such unrighteous deeds? See, violent sports, the faithful slave says, is unrighteous deeds, because the people want to hurt each other. It's not as some excuse, it's just playing the ball, because really they try to hurt others. And so we need to ask, do we just find it tasteless, or do we feel tormented when we come home and somebody has the program open where violent sports is played? Do we feel so tormented that we immediately shut it off, or are we getting excited ourselves and feel entertained by violence? Would that be right for Christians? So, that's a question. Another quote from Watchtower. Am I entertained by the spectacle of blood, death, or violence on television or on the internet with violent movies? It is worth remembering that Psalm 11:5 states, Jehovah himself examines the righteous as well as the wicked, and anyone loving violence his soul certainly hates. That's the principle. There's a highly competitive spirit out there at violent sports, and sometimes those playing on the games in games are paralyzed for life. And in movies, it's only fictitious, you know. They don't really get hurt. They're stunts. But on the playing grounds, it's real. Watchtower 84, October 1. Surely, reviling in highly competitive or violent sports activities are not reveling, I should say. Spending hours watching movies or television programs that features murderers, gangsters, and playing violent video games, then we are not unspotted from the world, but we want to be unspotted from the world. Another Watchtower said, it is not an exaggeration, therefore, to say what a person reads or sees has an effect on his attitudes. Hostilities are heightened so that often viewing violence leads to violence. And another quote, violence on television leads to aggressive behavior. So we need to see whether we want to be molded and stop viewing that, or whether we want to say, but I have the right to choose what I want to see. Up to you to make the decision. So certainly we want to cope with these temptations, even in school sports. One quote that was mentioned in The Awake says, the coaches taught us to play dirty. For instance, when we knew that an opponent had hurt his ribs, then the order was, pound his injured ribs. In fact, we didn't pull out injured two or three. If we didn't pull out injured two or three of their guys, it was really not a game. And that was school, not professional football, but school football. Another expert said, youngsters are taught to hurt, to cheat, to victimize for the god of victory. Coaches show high school and college teams violent films to psyche them for opponents or to stimulate them to have an aggressive behavior. We could go on and on. I have many more quotes. And quotes that appeared in the literature of the faithful slave. So I mentioned that nobody can say, well, this is Brother Lösch's personal viewpoint. No, It's what the faithful slave has printed as counsel. And we are so happy. We see that some are really willing to be molded by the literature, but also by our conventions. And in conclusion, I'd like to read you two very brief, nice notes that I got after a convention recently in Mexico, and I've translated that into English. It shows how the program of the faithful slave affects some to be willing to change. One young sister said from Tijuana, "I'm not a publisher yet, but I want to become one and also a regular pioneer. I'm 15 years old. I want to get baptized very soon, dedicate all my time that remains to Jehovah. The convention has strengthened me tremendously." Would you say that also the Circuitous Special Assembly Day has strengthened you? She says, "I promise to you that I will progress rapidly and be a faithful witness. I promise that I'll try hard and remain faithful to the end, following the example of Jesus and the anointed." And then another quote from a note that I got from an eight-year-old. "For me, it is a day of greatest importance because today I shall finally be a witness of Jehovah, although I'm only 8 years old." She was baptized with only 8 years. I think today we had one also about that age. She said, "I know it is a privilege of great responsibility, but I know that I'm not alone, but Jehovah will help me, together with my parents and spiritual brothers. I know that starting this day, nothing will stop me or you or my companions of the great crowd to follow the Christ." It was a handwritten note by an eight-year-old. Very nice to see. Now we had several getting baptized today, and this was the note I got after I started my talk. "Six sisters and five brothers, 11 baptized today, and we want to welcome them as brothers and sisters warmly." Would we be happy if we would learn that every weekend in the whole world would be 50 new ones getting baptized week after week? But what about if 500 would get baptized every weekend? Would it make us happy? But the reality is, brothers, every weekend the average of 5,700 are getting baptized week after week. Maybe some of you teenagers are still hesitating. So why don't you start Bible reading tonight and work your way towards baptism. Don't hold back. Give Jehovah your heart. And we see Jehovah blesses the worldwide work. We have a number of congregations represented here. But every week, brothers, we have more than 30 new congregations the world over. Every week, 30 new congregations are being formed. Obviously, Jehovah blesses the faithful service of his servants. A lot of activities going on in different countries, like in Mexico, a lot of Kingdom Hall construction. For the last 2 years in Mexico, every weekend they've dedicated 7 new Kingdom Halls. Every weekend in Mexico. And they had over 1.9 million at the memorial attendance, and worldwide we had this year, 1 million more than the year before. And so there's a great potential for future increase, and that makes us happy, doesn't it? So may we be resolved to continue faithfully, show the necessary humility, endurance, grow in our love, be willing to accept discipline and counsel, rely on the support of the Holy Spirit and God's holy word, and the assistance by the faithful and discreet slave class. If we be willing to accept this help, then certainly we can agree with the Apostle Paul, it stated in 1 Corinthians 10:13, "No temptation has taken you except what is common to men. But God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted or put on trial beyond what you can bear. But along with the temptation or trial, he will also make the way out in order for you to be able to endure it." This assurance applies to everyone who avails himself today for God's provisions. And what a wonderful assurance we have from our loving God, Jehovah, the great potter. What a privilege to be a beautiful vase in Jehovah's hand.
Brother Lösch, thank you very much for that fine information. We appreciate your coming to visit our circuit. We hope we've made you and Sister Lösch feel welcome.